Hey, can you hear me?
Okay. Yes, I can. You're working out every day. So do you have neighbors downstairs? Are you in a New York apartment or are you?
I'm in LA.
Oh, you're in LA. Okay.
I'm in my house in LA. I live in the hills. So
there you go.
I got a few neighbors on the sides, but everything's cool.
You're not making the kind of noise that's bothering them.
No, I'm not. I wear headphones. Oh, but you know what we do in the canyon is at 8 o'clock every night, everybody goes out to, you know, applaud the first responders and make noise. That's pretty fun because I live in this canyon. So you hear all the noise, like the acoustics are great. And it's just such a cool thing that my little neighborhood does.
Usually you're just worried about hearing wolves. Now you actually hear each other.
Coyotes. I think they all get because all the dogs start howling when we're all making noise. It's pretty funny.
Yeah, I had a girlfriend in the hills who had a little dog who she was constantly worried was going to be taken away by the coyotes. They were coming for him.
Yeah, I would. So. They're good meat out here.
Good eating.
Good eating for them.
So I am fascinated by not only your fine acting career, but your entire life, because you came up in St. Petersburg, which I have a little familiarity with because my best friend's wife came from St. Petersburg as well.
Oh.
We're all a lot older than you, but she did come from St. Pete. And it was a very, very conservative, staid, old money kind of place. Mm-hmm. And you seem to be like breaking down the doors all over the place.
Mm-hmm.
Was that just your nature from the time you were a kid? Were you just go, go, go? Or?
Yeah. I have to give a lot of credit to my parents. You know, I was born and raised in St. Petersburg, Florida. You're right. It is extremely conservative in that state, but now it's progressed a lot. And I came from a mixed household. You know, I have a Dominican mom, I have a white Jewish dad, but my brother and I, we were raised where education, exposure, and, you know, manners were kind of the three values in my house. So we grew up in a pretty progressive home, and I got into the arts very young. Started playing piano when I was like 4 or 5. I played piano all the way through high school, classical. But that's sort of how my journey started in music. And then I studied voice, and then that took me into theater, musical theater. And then in college, I auditioned for Juilliard. I got in. I decided to pursue a BFA in acting in New York. Yeah, and then I graduated, and I've been working ever since, thank God.
So you were always a performer by nature on some level?
Yeah. I was doing performing arts since very young. I think I have a memory of the first play I ever did, and it was at some kind of performing arts camp in St. Petersburg. I want to say it was like a Jewish performing arts camp, but I don't know. I was probably like 8, and the first role I had was playing Sebastian in The Little Mermaid. Even back then, they put me in the crustacean male part.
There you go. Well, you know, Disney, if they hear about this, we'll put you on the next sing-along, I guess.
Ooh, I would do it for free. I would love to do that. But yeah, my whole life, I guess, I've always been a very precocious kid, and I wanted to learn more. But my parents, they also supported that. They wanted us to be curious and learn more. And anytime we had any passions, they supported us and helped us learn more about it, get, you know, lessons and all of that.
So you skipped right past the Ringling Brothers circus camp and created your own.
Yeah, but I went to a lot of theater camps. You know, I went to Broadway Theater Project. I went to North Carolina School of the Arts. I founded the Performing Arts Project with some of my colleagues from Broadway Theater Project. I went to some arts camp. I can't remember the name. It's well known, near Woodstock. So I did a lot of theater growing up.
Did Juilliard change your perspective on all of this, or was it more the same?
Absolutely. I mean, there is nothing I will do more difficult than my experience at Juilliard. I mean, it kicks your ass. The teachers are the best in the world. They have no problem criticizing you. And that's good. That's really good for you. It requires a lot of humility and thick skin to do this business. you know, being too sensitive will run you out of town in this business.
So yeah. Did you muscle up emotionally to be part of a business, or have you always seen the business more clearly and just knew that it was part of this kind of part of the price you pay for what you do or what you want to do?
It's a growing curve, to be honest. I can imagine all the answers you've heard asking this of other performers and actors. It's personal and unique for everybody. But for me, I just knew that I loved this. I knew that I wanted to be an actor and a storyteller. And I knew that I had no other choice but to do it. That's kind of all I knew going in. And then I started to work, and I had never trained in front of a camera. But here I am 21, 22, and I got my first series regular role. I'd never been on a TV set. I didn't know what was happening. And I had to learn very quickly. You got to learn how to play with the other people. I was told a lot of negative critical things, you know, and you cry. And then you get up in the morning, you put your bootstraps on, and you figure out, okay, what can I control? What can't I control? What's important to me? What are my priorities? And that kind of comes with, I think it comes with age, to be honest, age and experience, and learning the kind of emotional fortitude that you need. And I like to say, you know, it's hard, but it's very gratifying, because this business will teach you, if you're willing to learn, and if you're willing to stay a little bit more humble and admit that you don't know everything and that you have more to work on, then this business will teach you how to believe in yourself and not take the world so seriously.
Mm. So in terms of moving from theater to television or film, very different work for you? I mean, because obviously there's the feedback you get emotionally immediately from an audience. Even in a drama, you're feeling the audience in that room with you. And obviously you're not on a TV set or a film set. Different kind of acting? Different? Does it change that for you? Or is it just you had to figure out what the technical pieces of that were?
It's, you know, acting on stage and acting in front of a camera are two very different experiences. The process by which I come to telling a story through a character is very similar. And that's really reliant upon my technique and my training that I learned over at Juilliard and have finessed over time to make personal for me. But when you're actually experiencing the act of telling the story, yeah, it's completely different. I don't know what, some people are like, oh, it's nothing, not different at all. Yes, it is. It is. Technically, it's very different. It's, you know, having a lens this close to your face versus having to fill a hall with 3,000 to 5,000 people. That requires a different faculty of a storytelling and process. So I had to learn as I go, you know. I feel very natural in theater because I grew up doing that, and I love being in a room with live human beings. That will never go away, and it will always be like a drug to me. I see theater as church. I take it that seriously. I'm the woman who's like, if you hear somebody like crinkling like a little job, I look at them like this. I'm like, how dare you? Or like people who wear frayed jeans to the theater. Oh my, where's the rest?
You haven't gone the full Lapone yet. Yeah. Just stop the show.
Yeah, I'm such a purist. I'm such a snob, such a theater snob. It's learning.
When I grew up, I'm 20 something years older than you. So when I grew up, you wore a suit on an airplane and you wore a suit to the theater without question. It wasn't like, you know, a sports jacket necessarily. You were like redressed for the theater.
That's how I was raised. So I'm like, oh, sorry. That was
okay.
Highlight. Hold on. Sorry. Still okay. Learning. Light, face.
Did you ever work in lighting on theater?
No. Can you tell?
Another skill set. Well, it's funny because you can see in all of these kind of things, now they're seeing it on all the talk shows and everything, who's lighting themselves well and who's, you know, figured it out and who hasn't.
And, you know. I'm not very good with like technology and computers and stuff. So sometimes my light goes out and my computer, I don't know.
I think Netflix has actually sent out a lighting package to their people when they're doing junkety things. They have a ring light.
Yeah.
They have like, tell them where to put it. And I think 60 Minutes apparently is sending out two cameras for people, or people are doing their computer and then they send a camera to set up to the side of your computer.
Oh, really?
Because I noticed on these interviews they've been having the last few weeks, there's a side shot of the person looking at the computer that matches the conversation. And like, apparently they've got like a whole system down now.
Wow. That's
kind of funny how innovation just evolves because
it has to.
Yeah.
And even like Trevor Noah's show that he's been doing, it's been getting really good ratings. And, you know, talking about it with my friends, I'm like, oh, maybe they will make drastic cuts because it's cheaper to produce and people are still tuning in, you know?
So fortunately for you, you don't need extremely good lighting. So
thanks.
There are people who definitely have lighting issues. You're doing fine. You're still youthful and happy. And
thank you.
Perfect. So anyway, theater. Is your church.
Theater. I was conservative in that way too. I grew up having to, you know, blow out my hair for the plane and wear something very nice to the theater, just like I would to synagogue. You know, it's having a lot of respect for the space that I'm in. I don't know. I value that. I think I'm a little old school, but I tend to err on the side of, you know, valuing and finding the integrity of the space that you're in.
Well, you know, I think there's something for the audience as a theater person myself, to some degree. You know, I think the choice to do that is part of the experience. And if people did it again, they would actually, after they're spending $150 a ticket, you know, would feel better about the whole experience. As it is, they have to give a standing ovation for every show, you know, because they're going to get their money out of it. But if you wear a suit and you're dressed properly, it's a different experience. And I think that's actually kind of a great thing.
Absolutely. I think that there's something fabulous about human ritual. And I was talking about this actually to a very really cool guy. He's not a rabbi. He's just sort of like leads this small pop-up synagogue in New York. And he was talking about how he's focusing a lot of his study on the act of ritual and how spiritual that can be. So even something as simple as putting on a suit jacket in the middle of the theater where there's nothing more human than connecting with other bodies in the room and no distractions from technology or anything, and showing up for that kind of experience, I think it's just one of the most powerful moments that we have to experience if we choose to. And it's fascinating that so many people choose not to. I always wonder what that's about, you know? I don't know if it's happiness or the world or if it's like an intentional choice, but I'm fascinated by that.
We had a Seder for 50 or so different people on Zoom a few weeks ago, and it was complete insanity. I mean, it was a mess in a lot of ways, but it was also glorious in a lot of ways because you were just having that, the choice to get along, to be there to tell the story, which is the whole point of Passover, was still there, even though it was just a complete mess on a lot of levels. You know, it wasn't controlled, it wasn't perfect, it wasn't exact, but still we were together and telling the story, and that was enough.
Yeah.
It's a funny thing. So going from being an ensemble, mm-hmm. you're still not a part of an ensemble in Hightown, but it's really your show. Mm-hmm. Is that scary? Is that a choice that you wanted? Is that it just came along? Or, I mean, how did that all evolve? And was it something you really wanted to do in terms of progressing through your career?
Yeah. I mean, you know, that thing I was talking about priorities earlier, I had to figure out what was important to me as a storyteller and as an artist. I knew that leaving Chicago was going to be a big risk. I didn't have any kind of job security going, you know, leaving Fire and moving back to LA. And that being said, I knew that I had to do something different because it was just, because I lead with my heart and I just knew that that's what I had to do. And I didn't know why. I just really trusted my instinct. 6 months later, well, before that, then I said, okay, you know what I want to do? I want to lead a show. I want to work on cable. And I want to do something messy. And 6 months later, Hightown came onto my desk and I auditioned for the show and I got the part. And I was like, you know, there might be something really there might be something to this, you know, Oprah concept of putting it out there and creating your intention and it'll manifest. So I don't know what it is, but I did have the intention and the desire to do it. And I'm very grateful and also very empowered by doing it. It is something that I wanted to do. I wanted to lead a show, especially as somebody who comes from, you know, a very marginalized group of people. I'm queer, I'm brown, Latina, I am Jewish. I mean, I'm all the things. I'm a woman. I'm all the things.
You're the Sammy Davis Jr. of your generation.
Exactly. You know, and there's a small Rat Pack. So it is important to me, and, you know, I don't know if it's cocky. It's just, it's intentional. You know, I have an intention, and it was a priority of mine because I knew that I would learn something about myself and I would push myself, and it was scary. It was very scary to do. And I like doing things that are scary.
Well, I mean, looking at your IMDb bio and stuff, you seem to be involved with a lot of boards and a lot of things that you actually are passionately part of. You're not just kind of a peripheral cog in these things. Also, it would seem that you grew up with, you know, financial stability at least, or maybe better than that. Do you have to push yourself to do those things, or do you, does it just come naturally that you, way you grew up, that your parents were participants in things and you, that's just how you approach the world?
I grew up definitely being told that supporting your community is important if you can. Becoming a part of the community, being able to make donations where you can. That it was actually mitzvot. It was a very Jewish approach growing up.
Well, also, you know, your parents both were involved enough in the world that I was able to look them both up. I was fascinated by your background. So I looked them both up, and they both have, you know, a long history.
Yes, very, very philanthropic. And that's something that remains to be a very core value in my entire family. So, you know, now after getting past the first third of my life and entering into adulthood, I'm very specific now about what I get involved with. I don't do a lot of macro organizations. I will intentionally be involved with usually micro organizations, maybe one or two in my hometown, maybe something here in LA. I need to be able to show my face. Otherwise, I read the papers, and there's a lot of organizations out there who prey on the ignorant. So I like to see where my money's going, and I like to be involved on a person-to-person basis if possible. I've taught in a lot of places. Mm-hmm. That's a pretty cool thing that I've discovered as an adult. Yeah.
Well, a lot of kids who grow up with parents like that end up, you know, they have the freedom to do nothing.
Yeah.
And it seems like you have the opposite tack. And I'm just kind of, guess I'm wondering whether that just, I mean, you've kind of answered the question, but whether that just came naturally to you or whether you really have to make the effort to make sure that you are fully invested in the world all the time. And that's, what it's all about.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's both. Maybe it's Mother's Day is coming up and I'm feeling particularly nervous, but my parents are huge with this. I give them a lot of credit. We've been traveling our whole lives. We were exposed to a lot of the world, and that very quickly, you know, my scope is a lot broader than I think the normal kid. So you understand pain and suffering, and you see that in the world. And it was something that we still practice as a family. Even last Christmas, we went to a local St. Petersburg homeless shelter and we fed the homeless. And it was so impactful that it's really an organization my mother loves, and my father decided to get into it. And, you know, this is just in my community, my hometown. So seeing them still be so proactive is very inspiring for me. And also understanding that by doing good deeds that you're actually serving others and in turn serving yourself. And that's something that is very important to me because it just feels like I can shed my ego, and having humility is something that I think is important to touch upon as an adult, to always check in and sort of put everything into perspective. You know, I don't have any children, so I have to I have to like teach myself. I don't have anybody else to teach. So it's my responsibility to figure out how to find grace, you know?
Not a responsibility everybody takes. So I honor that.
Yes.
My wife watches Chicago Fire. I do not, sadly. Was your character queer on that show?
No. Oh, no.
No, not at all.
There was this like, I don't know, fans really loved our couple. I was with Jesse Spencer's character, Matt Casey, and he's the lead of that show. And we were together the whole time I was on the show, and it was a very big deal, I think, when we broke up.
So do you think that Hightown, I mean, in terms of Hightown, was playing gay on camera and having a character be a lead of a show like that, was that part of something you were wanting, or was that coincidental? Do you think somebody knew about your personal life in some level and kind of looked for you, or how did that all work?
No, it was not something that I was intentional at all. I think it's awesome that I got a man playing a queer character, especially as a queer person. But it's not something I intentionally sought. What I intentionally sought was the quality of the story, the storytelling and the language, the text, the arc of it. The fact that she's queer was awesome and something we had in common, but definitely didn't put it on my list.
So what was the thing that most attracted you to the material?
It was Rebecca Cutter's writing. I thought that the themes of the show are incredibly topical, and I found to be a very fascinating backdrop for a crime drama. It's set in Cape Cod, which I had never seen. It's set on the backdrop of an opioid epidemic. So now we're talking about that in a way that seems a little bit more honest and messy. And then, you know, I'm dealing with a character who's an addict alcoholic. And I know that that is a really personal story for millions of people. So it just felt relevant. It felt necessary. And as an actor, it felt like a challenge. I have no idea if I succeeded, you know, but the process of becoming Jackie and telling that story that was very passionate to me was very life-changing. And it was the best job I've ever had. Honestly.
I've only seen the first two episodes, but one of the things that was striking about them was that it wasn't so much in a rush to get to an answer about anything. It was, they're very ambiguous through those first two episodes, and a lot of, even within those two episodes, things change, but you don't really know as an audience where it's going. Well, that's part of the draw, I guess. Do you know, is the arc of the first season definitive in some way, or does it continue to be, I mean, in some ways it's like a little like Sopranos energy, you know, where you kind of know the character, but you don't know where they're going. Your character in particular is also dealing with sobriety in those first two episodes, or lack of sobriety in those first two episodes. So we have no idea where that's going. Is it all just kind of like, does it go like that for an entire season? Does it feel that way throughout, or?
Some things begin to, not resolve, but I suppose progress. You'll start to see Jackie really battling with her sobriety, but eventually starting to understand the road of recovery and what that means for her. And then by the end of the first season, no, not at all. I don't think it's resolved at all. There's definitely a big cliffhanger, and I hope that there's a season two. But you get to sit with each character and see each character's point of view, even though Jackie's the leading one. You get to see what I love about the show is that there's all these different characters on the same web, and eventually they come and intersect, and it's all around this murder investigation. It's all around the murder of this girl, Sherry Henry. And that's the body that washes up on the beach that Jackie finds and kind of becomes her path of redemption. You know, she finds.
Oh, froze you.
Can you hear me?
Now I can hear you. Now you're moving again.
All right.
Sorry about that. Okay. You were telling us about her road to about the murder, about the dead girl.
Yeah.
And you were kind of just in the beginning of that when you froze for the last minute and a half.
I was just saying that her compulsion to be a part of figuring out who this girl's killer is her way into finding some kind of purpose or meaning. And I think it's sort of a path to redemption for her.
There's something nice about the show in that, I mean, there's a history of gay programming in the last few years that has been very, you know, specific. It's been the L word or whatever, and some of that's been very good drama, but it's not, this feels more like we're just in a town that happens to have a significant gay population, male and female, it seems. And it's just normal. I mean, that's kind of what, and there's a context to it besides being gay, I guess. The other shows seem to have been focused on romance and, you know, bad romance and good romance and whatever. But there's something really interesting about just having it in that world and not pointing it out and not obsessing on it and not overdoing it. That is kind of wonderful.
Yes, I completely agree. It was a big attraction to me too when I was reading the script, because that's a really specific step in the way of progress. You know, it's one thing to like embrace the LGBTQ community, starting to see these mainstream characters, but now we're in a space where we're starting to see that a queer character's sexual identity is not the main event of the story, that it just happens to be a characteristic. That's a huge step. That's a big progress, I think. But we're not talking about, you know, like, you know, L Word is like a soap opera, which is great. Right. It's about that. It's about being a lesbian in LA. It's not. Hightown is not about being gay. It's about a murder. It's a crime drama. And these are just, we just happen to be queer in this queer community. So you're right. I think it's so refreshing.
Mm. So did you shoot out there, or did you shoot combinations, or?
Yeah, we shot combinations. Most of it was shot in Long Island. And then we went to Hightown. We went to Provincetown and Hyannis in Massachusetts, and we shot there for about a week and a half.
Had you spent time in Provincetown before?
No. I had never been there. I'd never been to Cape Cod. So it was pretty fun. What a good town. People are great. And I got to see a couple friends who happened to be there, and I sort of like, they had been there before, so they sort of showed me the lay of the land, and it was beautiful. It's a really cinematic, it's a very photographic landscape there, so it was cool to work there.
And the combination of communities is fascinating, because there's that big Italian community, there's the mafia, there's the gay community, there's the school communities. I mean, it's like people you would not expect to be together in the same town, happily living, like, you know, just the community is very real there, very connected.
It's very inclusive. Everybody coexists. Yeah. It's a little bit of a utopia.
Yeah, with mafioso. You have to be, you know, where you're going. You have to be careful what restaurant you go to on a certain level. It's strange. Yeah, I have friends who went to school there, and so I was up there a number of times, and it's fascinating. I came in from New York. So is it different shooting? Was it the experience very different for you being the lead and being number one on that call sheet every day as opposed to being part of the ensemble?
Yeah, it was different. It was different, but it felt kind of natural to me. It felt like an organic step. I have a lot of opinions. I have a very specific point of view, and I would like to say that I trust my taste now in material. And so I felt really proud and confident to be leading a show. But because it's very important to me that everybody feels safe on a set and feels valued, and our producers and our directors and our creator, Rebecca, they went out of their way to make sure that they had such an inclusive, collaborative set. So it felt like everyone was a family, and even though I was technically the lead, you know, we were all very equal.
Yeah, it seems like you and James Dale, always want to throw the badge in there, are kind of on these all separate paths, separate but equal paths on some level. Mm-hmm. It's like I guess they'll conflict when they need to.
Yeah, you'll see Jackie Quinones' story, and you'll meet Ray separately, but eventually these two characters will come together. There will be an intersection. And at first our characters don't like each other. And then towards the end of the season, you start seeing us working together, and we have a newfound respect for each other, because I think we have more in common than we thought. You know,
yeah, he's a really interesting guy. I mean, I've spent some time with him over the years, and, you know, he's very, as an actor, very much internalized, very quiet man, who has a lot, but he has a lot going on in his head. He's definitely has a lot to say about the world.
Yeah. Yeah. He's wonderful. I love working with him so much. And I think he's very deep and layered, and that's what makes him such a good actor. You don't quite know what you're getting, you know?
Yeah.
I like it. I dig it.
And he likes that. He likes keeping the other actors off center a little bit. It's one of his things.
I know. It's great. We had a great time working together too. I think we both just, we work in the same way in that we like to throw and play and take risks. But we like to work with people. We don't really like working alone. So when you find somebody else who's willing to play that kind of ball, it's just such a joy. I really respect him a lot.
Do you have to make time? Do you have to like really make an effort to make that happen on an hour long show? I mean, you're under a lot of time pressure and a lot of schedule pressure generally on hour longs. Is that like something you really kind of like, let's make sure we do this or?
Yeah. You definitely have to make time for rehearsal and meeting and talking about the scene, talking about the characters and going over it with a fine tooth comb. For me, the more work and rehearsal, the better. I know not every actor functions that way, but I love like when he and I could go get lunch and we just talk about, you know, what are we doing here? What do we want? Not over prepare it, but make sure that we know what we're doing so that when, you know, when there's a surprise, we hopefully have an honest response to it.
And are you more about when the camera's rolling than you are about figuring out all those things out? Or are you really a person who wants to do the research and figure all those things out, and that's kind of the turn on of the work for you? Or is it both?
I think actually I'm more of the latter. I like to do a lot of the research and I like to come in having a full understanding, but when the cameras are rolling, sort of letting go and trusting that the work that I've done is already there to serve me. That's usually my goal. And it's rare that I meet it. You know, you don't hit it all the time, and that's okay too. But that's kind of the goal for me, is to work very hard at home, research, prepare, come in and let it go.
And the process of doing TV series, now you've been doing it for a few years, is that feel more like home, or are you happy with the idea of investing in your show, as it were, for 5 years or 6 years or whatever it is, and then figuring out what's happening then? Or do you have wanderlust? Or
I do. I always have wanderlust. I get very bored very quickly. But what's cool about cable is there's only 3 months to shoot, 4 months to shoot. You know, we have 8 episodes in one season. That's not a long time. So that means there's a lot of time to do other things. So I'll always be trying to work, but being on a TV set for so long, I have become very comfortable. It feels like home. And it's also a big reason how I got interested in directing, you know, was just having time to wait. And so because of that, I got very antsy, you know? So I started asking a lot of questions when I was in my early 20s and hanging out with the camera department and sort of being on TV sets so much, you know, I was, again, like I was very precocious and I didn't know anything about the world of television and film. So that was really my film school, learning it on the job.
Well, it seems like directing is kind of inevitably your future because you seem like that person.
I love it. I love directing so much. You know, it's
wonderful as actors are, you seem like a director in a lot of ways.
I mean, I am. I've directed. Right. And it's that I love, and I'll keep doing that, and I want to keep learning more about what that is. But I love it. It just really suits my brain. You're always solving problems. You're always putting out fires. There's never a moment where you're not doing that. And for some reason, it just like it clicks. I just really enjoy that, the process of constantly adapting and working and changing and trying to figure out how to tell the right story. It's like a perpetuum mobile. And I love that. I love living in that space.
Everywhere you described your acting. Sorry. we lost each other talking at the same time. What were you going to say? Sorry.
I said that's why quarantine can be really hard for me.
Think of all the movies you can prepare.
Yeah.
No, but it sounds like everything you've done fits that energy. Even your description of you as a kid sounds like a describe that kind of energy of doing, focusing, rethinking,
Yeah. Yeah. I have to be careful about it too. Like, you know, it doesn't always serve me to be like that. Of course, I've made some terrible decisions, but I do know that it's important for me to be productive, to feel purposeful, to find meaning in my work. So I try to do my best to fill that void wherever it may be. You know, I do call myself a storyteller. So that means that I'm not just one kind of artist. I like to inhabit as much as I can, whether that's through music or writing or directing or art, acting. You know, you make a living doing one or two things, but by no means does it mean that the other facets of the performing arts, you know, or the creative arts doesn't inform what that career is.
Yeah. My experience with actors who have been friends and directors also and writers is that ultimately that if you can afford, if you can survive to live and also do what your passions are and not indulge the, you know, the fat of the moment or the thing that's obvious and easy, it's always going to be happier 10 years later than, you know, just doing what was in front of you.
Absolutely. 100% agree.
Hmm. Well, thank you. You know, your publicist, even though she's not on the call because she'd be in a little box, mm-hmm. And she's still managing to flick the little red switch and say you have another appointment to get to. So,
very stealthy. You
know, she's good. She's really good. Anyway, thank you so much for your time. I appreciate it.
Yeah.
I hope the quarantine doesn't go too long.
Thank you. It was such a pleasure to talk to you, really. I really enjoy you and you're lovely. And thank you so much for giving me some time.
Thank you. And see you at the Whole Foods between us.
Whole Foods. Bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you.